Welcome. Yesterday we had an X flare. So far this year we've averaged about one X flare every month, so they're not a common event, so it's worth taking a look at more detail of what went on with it. Quick summary of the event. It was an X1.5 event. That's the sixth largest flare during solar cycle 25 so far. It was from active region 3386, right on the northwest limb. It started at 2145 UT, peaked at 2221 UT, and was over, according to the NOAA numbers, by 2242. You can see it's associated with this sunspot right on the limb here, shown with the blue arrow. So the first question to ask is, where did the flare occur with respect to the sunspot? And to do that, we're going to take a look at the Solar Dynamics Observatory AIA instrument, the 1700 angstrom channel. Now that one isn't used very much, but it's very useful from the point of view of locating flares, because you can see both the sunspots and the flare location on the surface of the disk. I've made a movie of this with 15 frames per second over a 3-hour period. So it was clear that the event occurred near the leading spot and in the trailing part of the region. So now let's take a look at, were there any ejecta associated with it? This is important because this leads to coronal mass ejections, and because this event is so far east, it can actually affect the Earth. To do that, we're going to look at the Solar Dynamics Observatory AIA 304 angstrom channel. That's the helium 2 304. It's an image of the transition region. The surface of the Sun is at about 5700 degrees Kelvin. The corona of the Sun is at about 2 million degrees Kelvin. And there's a region where the temperature and the density change very, very rapidly, called the transition region. And this particular line looks at that. So this is going to be a 6-hour movie at 15 frames per second. The solar atmosphere is divided into layers according to temperature. So we're going to go up in temperature now and look at the higher layer of the atmosphere. And we're going to take the temperature up by about a factor of 10 to about 500,000 degrees. To do that, we're going to use the SDO AIA instrument to look at 171 angstroms. This is going to be a 6-hour movie, again with 15 frames per second. One of the things that happens as you go up, the corona is made up of magnetic fields and hot plasma. The hot plasma sticks to the magnetic fields because it's unable to cross it, so it actually outlines the magnetic fields. So what we're going to look at here are post-flare loops. Now, post-flare loops occur when a big explosion occurs on the Sun and blows away or blows open most of the magnetic field above it. As the flare passes, those fields start to reconnect, creating an arcade of post-flare loops, and this is what you're seeing here on the right. So that's what to look out for in this particular movie. Going higher in temperature yet again, we're now up to 2.5 million by looking at the 335 angstrom channel of the AIA instrument. Again, it's going to be a 6-hour movie at 15 frames per second. So we're now looking at somewhat hotter loops. They are also magnetic structures and are containing plasma, but this time plasma that's very much hotter than the previous channels that you've looked at. Now let's take a look at the actual flare itself. We're going to use the hottest channel that is available on the Solar Dynamics Observatory. This is the 131 angstrom channel. We're looking at flare plasma at about 10 million degrees Kelvin. Again, it's a 6-hour movie, 15 frames per second, and any brightening on here is a flare of some sort. The bigger the brightening, the bigger the flare. At the very beginning of the video, you can see the coronal mass ejection being launched. Now we're going to look at the outer corona. The image in the middle of here is the sun at the size you've been looking at already. And then we're going to look at the really high layers of the atmosphere. Now these aren't particularly hotter. This is just scattering of the bright light of the solar photosphere off of particles surrounding the sun. Now when a coronal mass ejection occurs, which is an explosion of material away from the sun, you can see it using this particular type of instrument, a coronagraph. Blocks out the main part of the sun and then sees this scattered light. Now there's two coronagraphs evolved here. One is the red image here, which is the high resolution coronagraph, and that looks at the inner part of the outer corona. And then the blue one here is the C3 instrument that looks at lower resolution over a much larger area. Now you can see how big these structures are with respect to the sun. Now the event we're looking for is not the bright event that goes off to the southwest, but the one that fainter that goes off to the northwest. So what conclusions can we draw from all of this? This is the light curve of the X flare. It's the sixth largest flare since the beginning of solar cycle 25, which is in January of 2020. And in fact, it probably goes back many years before that because the decay phase of solar cycle 24 was very, very weak. It produced a coronal mass ejection, but will it affect the Earth? Was it too far east to be impacting the Earth? We'll have to wait and see. It produced a proton event at Earth, which is not surprising, but it wasn't a very strong one. It also produced a strong radio blackout, an R3 event, which was not surprising. And we can expect more of the same in the next 2 to 4 years. So it's going to be an exciting time to be observing the sun. So thank you for watching. And until next time, stay safe and goodbye.